Okay, today we'll start with the next topic, user interface for operating systems. Okay, so we have completed in the previous class, we have completed about the services of the operating system. This we'll have an overview of the things. So when we come to the concept like operating system, in operating system we have user interface, system calls and various services. So we have services like program controls, input output control, file systems, communications, error management, resources, alting, security. This is what we have seen in the previous classes, all the services of operating system. So next what we have is user interface and system calls. So these are the things that an operating system is going to have. So first we will see what are user interfaces, then we'll come to what are various system calls. So when we come to something like user interface, I've gave you overview what is user interface also. Like we'll be having two types of user interfaces. One is command line, other one is graphical. Command line also I've explained you. I've opened a DOS operating system. Remember? I've opened an operating system, DOS operating system.
Yes.
And I've explained you. It is going to be completely command line based. If you want, I'll show the things again. Okay. I'll show the things again for you. Just type CMD at the start menu. Then it will take you to a command prompt. I hope everybody is able to see the screen.
Yes, sir.
It will take you to the command prompt. At the command prompt, it will be coming in the form of command. So if anything, if you want to just type the command, DIR is for listing of the files and directories. So these are the files and directories I am having in my drive. Suppose if I want to go to D drive, so just type D colon enter, it will come to D drive and it is showing the files. I don't have any files in D drive. Sorry, these are the files. So like this, everything is going to work based on the commands. That is why it is called as command interpreters or command line user interfaces. Okay, so that is how the command line interface is going to work. Then other one what we have is a graphical user interface. Graphical means, basic example which we can take is a mouse which works with the help of mouse. That is Windows. Not only Windows, we have many other things like Linux, Mac, many operating systems which support graphical user interfaces. Okay, so we'll just see something in detail about these two operating systems. So as I've given an example, in DOS, that is disk operating system, we have two types especially. One is MS-DOS. MS-DOS stands for Microsoft Disk Operating System. Then one more thing what we have is PC-DOS. PC-DOS is Personal Computer Disk Operating System. That is, if what I've done is, from Windows, I've opened a DOS. So that comes under category of Microsoft Disk Operating System. Without Windows, if DOS is installed, that is Windows support will not be there, only DOS will be there. Then that is called as Personal Computer Disk Operating System. So it depends. DOS can be working with the help of Windows, without help of Windows also. Okay, we'll see that later. Now see here. When we come to the user graphical interface is nothing but it works with the help of mouse, that's the first thing, keyboard and monitor. Then it will be having something like icons on the desktop, we'll be having icons, programs, files, many things will be there. So those are what we called as icons. Then uses various mouse buttons and object interfaces and other various things. Like if I want to open a file, I can open with the mouse. If I want to close a file, I can go close with the mouse. Whereas in command prompt, everything has to be based on commands only. If I have to open a file, also I have to type a command. If I have to close a file, also I have to type a command. If I have to list the files, I have to type a command. So everything will be based on commands. So that is the difference between command and the graphical things. So a continuation to this graphical user, we'll be having both the things, that is command line interface and graphical user. That is what I have seen just I have shown you. That DOS is working on Windows. The That is, command line interface and graphical user are both working together. So most of these things are included like this now. Not only for Windows, even for Mac, Apple also, we have GUI with CLI. Even for Linux also, we have the same options. Excuse. So now most of the operating systems are working GUI with the help of CLI. Previously, they were separated. Command line was separated, graphical users were separated. But both of them are working nowadays in Unity. Graphical user as well as command line interfaces. Now next is if you come to mobile. In mobile, most of the things, the new interface that we have is touch screen. If you come to the olden things, olden days, we don't have anything like a touch screen. We have only mouse and keyboard. Using mouse and keyboard only we used to do the things. But now most of the laptops also have become touch screen laptops. Okay, not only mobiles, the laptops also have come as touchscreen laptops. By touching, you can open icon. By touching, you can close the icon. So many of the things are there. So mouse is not possible or desired over there. It is not required. Mouse is not required. Just with your touch, we can do the things. And selections can be made on gestures. And virtual keyboard also will be available for entering of the things. So keyboard requirement is also will not be there. Everything can be based on touch screen only. So that is a new interface which is coming up. So the interfaces what we have in the book is command line interface and graphical user interface. Now the new interface which is not updated to the books is touch screen interface. Clear? So these are the three interfaces that we are going to have specially. Is Prashant any doubt, ma?
Yes.
Okay, no, you have raised your hand. Then as I was saying, the next thing what we are going to have is something like system calls. What is a system call exactly? Suppose simple example, I'll tell you. I'm writing a program. Everybody have written a program in C language, right? C or C++. I don't think there might be a person who has not written a program in C or C++. And a few people are putting off your camera, just put your cameras on. Yes or no? Everybody have written the programs in C or C++?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Now, when you are writing a program, suppose you have written a command, cout. Cout, welcome to C language or welcome to C++. What is the statement going to do? What is the statement going to do? As far as we know, the statement is going to print something on the output screen. Yes or no? It is going to print something on the output screen. That is what we know. But exactly what is happening inside is that program is going to work in different ways. What are those different ways? I'll tell you. Okay, I'll explain you in the later slides. See you. I've written a program. The program has to be executed. The user program has to be executed. So here when the program has to execute, we'll be having two things. One is something called user mode, and other one is what we call as kernel mode. Every operating system will have these two things. One is user mode and other one is kernel mode. So what is happening in user mode and what is happening in the kernel mode, we'll see that. Then you'll be able to understand what is a system call. Now when we come to the user mode, we are writing a program. Once we have written a program, we are trying to make the program run. When we are trying to make the program run here, what is happening is the program will go to something called as kernel mode. And it will execute the program in the kernel mode. Simple example I can tell you. Suppose I've declared a variable int a. And I've given some value a is equal to 10. Everybody have declared the variables, right? We have declared one or the other variables inside a program.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So I've declared a variable something like int a is equal to 10. Some variable I've declared like this. I've declared something like int a is equal to 10. I've declared a variable. Now for this variable, what will happen when the program is running, the value has to be assigned to this variable as 10. and where that value is going to be stored in a computer memory. That is what we know. But for an operating system, what it will do is, when the program is executing, this value or the variable has to be stored inside something called as kernel mode. It cannot be stored in user mode. That is, if you observe here, get a system call. That is, from this user mode, the program has to go to kernel mode and get executed for every statement. Not only this, any statement, if I write cout, that statement has to be printed. So whenever a statement has to be executed, it has to go from the user mode to the kernel mode. The program or a statement will be executed in the kernel mode, and the executed statement, that is output of this statement, will be returned to the user mode. That is how the program is going to run exactly. So any operating system will be having two things, user mode and kernel mode. So what is happening is, the program will start running from the user mode. So every statement, first statement, it will go to kernel mode, execute it, then the executed statement will be returned to the user mode. Then second statement also will come to the kernel mode, get executed and returned to the user mode. That is how the program is going to work exactly inside an operating system. So any values have to be stored. If a value has to be stored, the values will be stored in the kernel mode only. It cannot be stored in the user mode. So we have two types of modes, kernel mode as well as user modes. Remember these two terms. So in a system call, we'll be having two things, user mode and kernel mode. User mode is just going to execute the things, and exact execution will be done in the kernel mode. That's what is going to happen. Here I have explained you what is the kernel mode and user mode. In a kernel mode, the CPU is in kernel mode, means the code is getting executed and can access the memory of any hardware resource. So from the kernel mode only, you can access the hardware components. It can be CPU, it can be mouse, it can be keyboard, anything can be done when the program is in your kernel mode. Simple example I can tell you. Suppose if your mobile is there. Mobile will have two things, standby mode and the working mode. Yes or no? Standby mode means when the screen is blank, then we can call it as standby mode. Will it operate in the standby mode? No. It will operate when the screen is on only. So same way, here also we'll be having two modes, user mode and kernel mode. So when the program is in kernel mode, then only it will get executed, then it can access the memory and the hardware resources like hard disk or RAM or anything. Hence, kernel mode is very privileged and powerful. It is very powerful mode, as it can access the hardware components. It can be hard disk, it can be RAM, it can be any of the things. But one important thing that we have to remember, if a program is crashed in kernel mode, if the program is crashed in the kernel mode, the entire system will be altered. Means the system is going to hang up. Most of the time it will happen in your mobiles. The mobiles will be hanged. Suppose if you are opening a program, the mobiles will be hanged. So that is because of this. If the program is crashed in the kernel mode, the system will be altered. Whereas in user mode, when the user is in user mode, the program don't have direct access to the memory or hardware resources. This memory or hardware resources are accessible only from the kernel mode, not from user mode. And if a program is crashed in user mode, then only that particular program is altered, not the entire system. If the program is crashed in kernel mode, entire system is altered. But if program is crashed in user mode, only that program is altered, not the system. Clear? That means the system is in safe state. It is not crashed. Hence, most of the programs in OS runs in user mode. When required, only it will go to kernel mode. When required, only it will go to kernel mode. If you have seen the previous slide, the program is almost getting in the user mode, executed user mode. When required, and it is going to the kernel mode and coming out of the kernel mode when the program is executed. Clear? All are able to follow this, ma?
Yes, sir.
Fine. Yeah. Now we'll see what exactly is a system call. When a program is in user mode, it requires RAM or hardware resource, but it must ask the kernel to provide the access to the resources. This is done via something called a system call. That is, when a program has to access, when a program has to execute, it requires RAM and it requires hardware components to execute. Suppose I have written a simple program C out. So if that program has to execute, it has to be displayed and it has to occupy some memory in the RAM. So when it has to work, it has to occupy the memory. The memory can be has to be accessed or memory has to be requested. That requesting of the memory can be done only from the kernel mode. We have seen the previous slide. The memory, suppose I want to execute C out, hello, welcome to C++ or welcome to operating system. So this idea, this executed program or this statement which has to be executed from user mode, it has to go to kernel mode. It has to access the request, then it has to come back. That accessing of the request is what we call as system call. Okay, from user mode it is moving to the kernel mode, from kernel mode it is coming back to the user mode. So this is what we call it as calling a system or system call. Followed this, everybody? What is a system call exactly? Everybody, yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. So when a program makes a system call, the mode is switched from the user mode to kernel mode. Okay, when the program is making a system call, the mode will be switched from user to kernel mode, and this is called as context switch. That is, switching from user mode to kernel mode by making a system call is called as context switch. I want everybody to make a note of these points. When a program is in user mode, it cannot access RAM or hardware. So for this to access, it has to move to kernel mode. So for moving from user mode to kernel mode, that is called as system call. Okay, that is, the mode switching from user to kernel is called as system call. And the moving of the things is what we call as context switch. So I want everybody to make a note of these points. Then the kernel provides the resources. That is, whatever the resources the program requires, the kernel will be providing the resources. After that, another context switch happens. That is, it is a continuous process. I will not execute only one program and stop. There will be some n number of programs, one program after another, one program after another. So it will be moving from user mode to kernel, kernel to user, user to kernel, kernel to user. So it will be switching the modes from user to kernel mode to user mode, which results in changing of mode from kernel back to user mode. Okay, so it will be continuously moving the process from user to kernel, kernel to user, user to kernel to user. So that moving of the modes is what we called as context switch. Okay, so this is what about system calls. Okay, I'll try to explain an example also. In general, a system calls require the following things. If a system requires, if it has to create a file, if it has to delete a file, if it has to read the data, or if it has to write the data, for everything we require a system call. For creating a process, for deleting a process, we'll see what is the process later on, don't worry. Suppose if I have to access a file from internet, we require a system call. If I have to send a file over internet, if I have to send a file in WhatsApp, then I require a system call to send the file. To receive the file, I require a system call. To access the hardware components, I require a system call. So for every simple operation, I require